Hello all, welcome to VTV V-Shikshana program. This lecture is about daylighting. This is the last module for the climatology subject for BEAC for the students of BEAC in third semester. So the overview of this presentation, so we'll start with the basics of what is source of daylight and what is sunlight, what is difference between daylight and sunlight, and why daylighting. Of course, what is the reason daylighting in buildings, and then we'll try to understand what are the different sources of daylight. It is also the sunlight which is considered as daylight, but again different elements in a building use the daylight, and then it is transferred into the interior buildings in different way. So the way the sunlight is harvested in different by different elements is considered as different sources of daylight. Okay, so what is we'll also study what is daylight factor, and how massing and orientation will influence the daylighting of a building, and what are the different components of a daylight devices. Okay, so starting with basics, as I told earlier, sun is a main source, or you can say ultimate source of daylight. Okay, so that is naturally available and abundantly available. Now this sunlight, or this natural source of daylight, is not just getting the light, it is also giving us the heat, that is thermal radiation. Okay, so when we try to harvest light, we are also getting heat along with this light, and this is very much beneficial for cold climates. In cold climates, where they want solar heating, or where they want inner spaces to be heated, so they can harvest a lot of sunlight and get the benefit of daylight, that is natural sunlight. But whereas in tropical places, or you can say warm or humid or hot humid places, where there is abundantly available, the solar radiation is abundantly, or it is more compared to you can say the polar regions or cold areas. So there, along with the sunlight, we are also getting a lot of thermal radiation, which is not actually preferred for tropical climates. So hence, we need to use this daylight in such a way that we are using only the diffused or reflected light, which is not getting heat inside the building, which is just getting the lighting aspect of the, you can say, daylight. Okay. So that is why we need to understand how we can harvest this sunlight in cold climates, as well as in hot climates or tropical climates. Okay. So lighting in indoor environment can be considered mainly three basic purposes. Okay. So one is to enable occupants to work or move in safety, move about in safety, like if they want to have to work and these things. It can be factory, it can be college, it can be office, it can be school. So whatever this thing, so it has to be, they need to move properly. I mean, they get enough luminance or lighting inside a building. Second is to enable task that is performed. So different task will require different levels of lighting. Let's say if there is a stitching or knitting work, it might require more light, because, or if they are doing miniature paintings, so there is a lot of detailing, and there is, let's say, small, let's say microscopic things, or any task which is related to very minor detailing, so that might require more lighting. And some task which is like, let's say, working on a computer will require less light, because the screen is radiating light, or the screen itself is servicing. But again, they also need some light to operate maybe keyboard and walk around. So different spaces will require different level of light, different quality of light also. It is not just what is the lighting level, it is also what kind of light. I mean, it is a light along with the heat, or it is what is the color of the light. So all these plays an important role in enhancing the quality of indoor environment. So that is making the third point, that is to make interior to look pleasant, to have a different ambience, whatever ambience you wanted. Like a bedroom requires a different lighting than, let's say, a living room or a kitchen, okay, or a bathroom. Okay, so different activities that are performed, different tasks that are performed in different zones or areas of any building requires different lighting. Okay, so this basic principle is to one is to help in functioning, smooth functioning of different activities, and also to provide comfort and aesthetics. Okay, so these can be, you can say, the three basic purposes why do we have lighting. Okay, and we can always achieve lighting in buildings by mainly two ways, that is, one is either natural or artificial. Okay, so natural is again daylight that is received from the sky or sunlight. Okay, so sun is the source of natural light, and artificially by electrical lamps, by tube lights, or various other, by LEDs, CFCs, or various other artificial lights. Okay, so we can actually use these two methods, but we'll try to use more of natural or passive ways of daylighting. Okay, now daylight, which is natural, which is available for us in this visible light. Okay, so there is again the visible light is again classified into different wavelengths. The visible light wavelength is ranging from 800 nanometer to 400 nanometer. So that light is considered as visible, which is more than that, it is considered as infrared, or it is also considered, or other side, it is known as ultraviolet. Okay, so morning we receive light, which is again ultraviolet rays and these things, and during afternoon or evenings, which carries a lot of heat. So then there is, you can say, infrared rays. Okay, so even ultraviolet rays also carry some amount of heat, but infrared are again, you can say, long wave radiations and short wave radiations. So they also have different property. Okay, so this is nothing but again the radiation spectrum, and especially showing the visible light. Okay, the spectrum for the visible light, and wave of slightly higher wavelength, it is red in color, and with the as we go down, there is orange, yellow, green, blue. That are green and blue are considered as cool colors. They are also having a less wavelength, and violet is considered to be the least, that is 400 nanometer. Okay, so this is the radiation spectrum of the visible light that is available for us to harvest as daylighting. Okay, now daylighting has two different sources, we can say. The sunlight and the skylight. The difference between the sunlight and skylight is, sunlight, when we receive the light from the sun, which is not diffused, or there is direct radiation, or it is you can say, after selective attenuation by the atmosphere, where it is not reflected, or there is not much of diversion, and there is direct sunlight that is falling on the surface of Earth. So that can be considered as, that is usually considered as sunlight. Skylight is, of course, it is not direct, and it might be diffused. It might be diffused because of the atmosphere, the particles that are present in the atmosphere, because of gases, because of clouds, okay, or various other things. So this is, you can say, skylight is nothing but reflected or diffused sunlight. And sunlight is nothing but again direct sunlight. Okay, direct light from the sun is considered as sunlight. Diffused or reflected can be considered as skylight. Okay, so this lighting, which helps in, you can say, direct light or sunlight or even skylight, it helps not just physically, it is also helping psychologically. It is more important to admit or to harvest light inside the buildings. Okay, so it provides a more pleasant atmosphere inside a building, and it is superior quality of light compared to artificial lighting. The natural light is more superior as compared to artificial lighting, and is often necessary for specialized tasks such as color matching, which may be getting influenced because of the artificial lighting. Okay, so we'll also study color rendering, in which we try to enhance colors or these things by using certain lights. So that is called as color rendering. But during daylight, we can manage specialized tasks, like what is the actual color of that particular material object. Okay, so it provides a more pleasant atmosphere and also superior quality of light. That is the daylighting, that is the from the natural source of sun. And this sunlight, which also provides our body, it is also the only source of vitamin D. Okay, and it has also been proven that daylight affects like it reduces the effects of seasonal affective disorder. Okay, and there are various other. It increases the indoor environment, and it also increases the, you can say, the productivity, and the, it is also psychologically very uplifting. It is also helps psychologically to achieve certain activities, to perform certain activities, or to achieve certain goals and these things, to perform better. Okay, so psychologically also, not just physically, psychologically also, daylighting, that is natural source of light, is very helpful. So that is why we need daylighting, because it is a passive strategy. When I say passive strategy, it is not consuming more energy. So that is, it is reducing energy demand, and it is abundantly available in nature. Okay. And with little modifications, we can harvest a lot of daylighting. Okay. It is not, we are not dependent on any other secondary these things while harvesting the natural daylight. Okay. So it reduces the energy demand. If you are not using daylighting, then we have to switch to, let's say, artificial lighting, which again increases the energy demand. So that is why daylighting is very good, because it consumes almost, the lighting in any buildings will consume about 30% of the energy. Okay. So major energy is consumed by, let's say, HVAC or ventilation systems. But you can say 30% of energy today is consumed by, you can say, by daylighting. Okay. It also provides comfort, that is psychological and physiological comfort, and hence it also increases the productivity. Okay. It has been observed nowadays in corporate, many of these corporate companies and these things, they are also trying to use lot of daylight and trying to increase the indoor environment. Okay, so indoor air quality, indoor environment, and they have seen that there has been a considerable change in productivity. So they can spend longer hours if they are exposed to sunlight, and it is also causing less impact if they are exposed to sunlight, and psychologically. Okay, so they have a better mental fitness who is exposed to sunlight for quite a longer period than compared to artificial lighting. Okay, so that is why daylighting is very important in any building. Okay, so light, as we say, transmission of light. So light travels through different mediums. It can travel through air, it can travel through glass or water. So there are some materials which will allow light to pass through them. So they are called as transparent, and which doesn't allow are called as opaque. And third category is nothing but translucent. That is material which transmit only a part of incident light. Okay, so other part is again, it is not exactly transferred, or it is not transmitted. It is diffused, reflected, or refracted. Okay, so we can say that transparent materials can be used where you want to have a visual connectivity, opaque where you don't want any light to pass through them, and translucent where you want the brightness of the light but you don't want the visual connectivity. Okay, so there you get only the light, these things, and you don't get the actual visual connectivity for two different zones or rooms or areas. Okay, so then you can use different materials to either allow or to stop, or to partially allow and missing. Okay. Now there are three, you can say, qualities. That is light, either it is experiencing reflectance when it hits any object, it will either absorb or it will either transmit. Okay. So light, when hits any, from the source, when hits any plane or object, it will either reflect or it will either absorb or it will transmit. Okay, so in any case, we can say that the resultant of, you can say, reflectance, absorbance, and transmittance is one. Okay, so if you say one is 100%, so then the summation of these things, like let's say in case of there is opaque objects which doesn't allow any light to pass through them, then the light is either reflected or transmitted. Okay, so light is either reflected or absorbed. It is not transmitted. Okay, so then we can say, so similarly, if let's say if the light is very much reflective, if it is let's say mirror, then it reflects 100% of light. So then there is no absorbance, or there is very less absorbance, and there is no transmittance. Okay. So similarly, you can say the product, or you can say the summation of either light when falls on any surface, it is partially reflected or absorbed or transmitted. Okay. So either of three things can happen. Okay. It can either reflect, absorb, or transmit. Okay. Now reflection again can be like a specular reflection, where the same source of light is completely reflected, or it is spread to a smaller extent, or it is completely diffused from the source of light. Okay, so this is different materials. Again, the texture of these materials and the reflective property of these material will achieve different functions, that different way. That is, either it will reflect 100% or most of the light, either it will spread a little bit, or it will be completely diffused. Okay, so based on the requirement, we can use different types of surfaces for the reflection. Okay, now illumination quality is nothing but the it is mainly dependent on the, that is nothing but lighting inside any space is considered as illumination. So illumination, that is it is nothing but the measurement of lighting, and it is measured in terms of the quality, that is color of light. So we get natural light has a different color than a fluorescent light or incandescent light. So there is a color of light that is different for different sources. A color rendering is nothing but again how do I can enhance by using different colors. Light distribution, that is again direct or diffused light, will have different quality. That it direct light carries a lot of heat, diffused light doesn't carry a lot of heat. So again, freedom from the glare. Light also causes glare. That is direct sunlight, it causes glare, so it might create blindness or difficulty or discomfort. So that is why we try to avoid the glare. And a good illumination, or you can say good lighting, must have freedom from the glare. Now luminance distribution, so that is also considering various properties of surface. Like we have reflecting, or reflecting which is also a diffusing light, which is completely specular reflectance, or you can say it is spreading, or it is completely diffusing. So based on that surface quality, either it is a glossy surface or matte finish, so based on the surface quality also the illumination needs to be changed. Okay. So controlling daylight, mainly we can say there are three methods. So one is fixed external, that is we are having members or elements in buildings which are permanently fixed. So that can be, let's say, concrete slab, or it can be a wall, or any other permanent member or permanent object. So that is again reflecting light, or it is trying to obstruct light. Okay, so that is why you can say control. You can either reflect, or you can control, or you can partially control or partially reflect. So that is called as fixed external. Variable external is which the member or the object or the panel which will allows the maximization of skylight but can suffer from maintenance problems. Okay, so this variable external in which we can perform based on the requirement. Okay, so we might be needing more light, more reflecting, or we want to obstruct light. So then maybe by operating the angles, or even some kind of you can say photochromatic glasses, so they will change based on the requirement of internal environment. Okay, or internal lighting illuminance requirement. So based on that, we can actually change. It is adjustable. So then it is considered as variable external. Variable internal, where the object, or we can say the device, is fixed inside, where we can, by inside only, we can control the radiation. It can be blinds, or it can be sometimes it is light shelves, or maybe different panels and devices. Okay. So that we can use it for to control the daylighting. Now sources of daylight, as I said earlier, so it is considered as the direct sunlight that is reaching from the sun to the other thing. So that is considered as skylight, sunlight, direct sunlight. And there might be some light which is reflected from an external surface. So it might be a neighboring building, which is reflecting light. It might be a water body or snow cover which is falling on the surface of that particular object or external object, and it is reflecting light inside a building. Okay, so that is considered as external reflected sunlight. And then there is some reflection that is there is some kind of reflection that is happening in the inside spaces also. The walls might reflect some sunlight, or the floor or the roof might reflect, or any object within the you can say inner interior inside a building, so that might reflect sunlight. Okay, so that is considered as internal reflected sunlight. Okay, so there and the last is again the light which is diffused, okay, and from the sunlight, that may be skylight, or it can be diffused because of the atmosphere and this thing. So there is also diffused light which reaches the inside in the indoor environment. Okay, so daylight can be understood how to what kind of daylight or these things by these four things, that is direct sunlight, diffused light, externally reflected sunlight, or internally reflected sunlight. So all these four will contribute to the daylight factor. Now daylight factor is nothing but it is what is a you can say comparison of external illuminance to internal illuminance. Okay, so for that we need to again consider the direct sunlight. Daylight factor is nothing but what is the sky component is considered as direct sunlight, what is the reflected sunlight, reflected from external source and reflected from internal source. Okay, so all these three together, all these combined to understand what is daylight factor. Okay, so by definition it is nothing but the percentage of the ratio of internal illuminance to the external illuminance. So like whatever the ratio, it is measured in terms of percentage, so that gives us the daylight factor. So daylight factor is nothing but the percentage ratio of interior illuminance to the percentage ratio of you can say exterior illuminance. Okay, so that gives us daylight factor. Now massing of for daylighting, so the building mass, that is nothing but what kind of shape of the building, what kind of form of the building, what might be the shape and form of the building, that is which side it is facing, and based on the sun path we can say we can harvest lighting in different forms. Okay, so now we can say, let's say consider three forms, that is U shaped or O shaped, that is, or square shaped with a central cutout, or H shaped or I shaped. Okay, so they allow different buildings. So let us consider if this was a rectangle building. So only on the end where there are windows will be getting light. But whereas if you want to harvest a lot of light inside, so then we can use these kind of forms. Okay, so most of the buildings are used in these forms or where they can achieve more daylighting. Okay, so more so surface is exposed, optimum surface is exposed to the sunlight, so that it absorbs or we can harvest daylighting. Okay, so it is also important what kind of light. So whether we are using north light, south light, east light, west light, and which part of the time for that particular activity. Okay, so for different activities we harvest light from different directions. Okay, so massing also plays an important role, because it is also not just absorbing light, it is also increasing heat gain. Okay, so we need to make sure that we are only harvesting light for the brightness, not for the thermal quality of that particular light. Okay, so and also depends on which part of the world you are, so that you need either thermal heat gain or no. Okay, so based on that we can do the massing for the daylighting, and try to understand which area can be shaded, which can we can use lot of light. Okay, so that is also nothing but again orientation. So which is the orientation of building which you can harvest lot of sunlight. Okay, if you want to use lot of sunlight during day or during morning or during night. Okay, for tropical climates it is considered the longer axis to be in the you can say east west direction. Okay, and the longer axis that is the longer facade will face either north light or south light. North light is considered to be very good source of direct sunlight, because it is carrying lot of diffused light. Okay, there is no direct sunlight, or there is very less direct sunlight in these tropical countries. Okay, but whereas they receive some light during afternoon, which can be easily taken care by the extended, you can say extended shading devices, which will cut down only some time, or you can say the daylight during, let's say, summers or during the hotter period. Okay, so that will cut the sunlight, and it will allow the reflected or diffused light. Okay, so but whereas towards the south, it has a larger penetration of sunlight, so that can be easily you can say reduced by using overhangs. But whereas towards north, you can say there is no direct sunlight, or very less direct sunlight throughout the day. Okay, so if you are trying to orient towards longer axis towards north south, so because of the sun altitude in the morning and during after the rising and before sun setting, so there is lot of light and heat penetration inside the building. This will increase the solar heat gain of the building. Okay, so that is why it is ideal in tropical climates to have orientation of building in the longer axis in the east-west direction. Okay, so that the longer facade is facing towards north and south. Okay, so similarly, there are again various components, different ways to ensure daylighting inside the building. Okay, so there is a top, we can harvest light from the top, from the windows. There is clear stereo windows, borrowed lights, lights shelves, okay, and all combination of these. So we'll try to understand how we can harvest different sunlight in different ways, okay, inside a building. Okay, now let us consider this building, in which you can see that only on the periphery, that is marked in yellow, is having very good daylight. But whereas inside, which is again a slight pink, you can say that is partially having daylight, and the interior is not having daylight at all. Okay, so there is no daylight for the 16% of building, whereas only the light is penetrating only up to 5 meters, or you can say 15 feet. Okay, so rest of the area is not getting daylight. So that is why when we try to do the massing, we try to use, we give courtyard, so that there is some light that is penetrating from the courtyard to these buildings. Okay, so that is why these kind of arrangement. So we can see on the right, because of the linear, or we can say rectangle arrangement, so this is getting more daylighting. Okay, so here what we can see in the second option, where most of the area is getting good daylighting, and some area is, you can say 25% is getting partial daylighting, and there is no area where there is no daylighting at all. Okay, so this is the same area, which is again by using different form or different massing. Okay, similarly, there is section aspect ratio, so which basically works on a thumb rule, that it is nothing but the ratio of the opening of the skylight to the depth of that particular skylight or atrium. Okay, you can say atrium or skylight. Okay, so if it is less than 2, then it is called as narrow, and the below floors might not be getting efficient daylighting. Whereas in second, these things, where if the ratio of the width of opening to the depth of the opening of the skylight is less than 1, then that is getting very good skylight in major part of the building. Okay, so we can say to all major floors, or to all the floors of the building. Okay, similarly, there is a plan aspect ratio. If the this is a courtyard, and if the ratio of length and width of a courtyard is let's say 1, it is equal, then it is considered as square atrium. And if the length is more, or you can say it is the length aspect ratio is a plan aspect ratio is less than 0.4, so then it is considered as linear atrium. Okay, so this is also very efficient. So it has to achieve either linear or you can say square atrium to have a sufficient lighting. Okay, now lighting is also harvested from ceiling by different ways. We can say here it is clear story on the left, so that is monitor, sawtooth, or north light also, and skylight also. We'll try to understand each in this thing. Where clear story, here it is trying to achieve to get reflected light or light from the ceiling. Okay, so this is another story. So it is considered as, this portion is considered as clear story. Okay, so this arrangement is considered as a monitor. Here you can see it is a sawtooth, and this kind of arrangement is usually used to harvest north side sunlight, okay, which will object or which will block the sunlight from the south side, and which will allow only north side sunlight. It will get reflected from this surface, and it is supplying sufficient lighting to the inner spaces. So there is, we can harvest lighting from ceiling in different ways. And when we use sunlight or we use skylight, because there is no openings or we can't borrow light from the sideways. Okay, but if we are borrowing light from the sideways, we can use combination of sunlight and also from the windows, where the internal portion is not getting sunlight. So that is why we can use skylights, and it is spread at a regular interval, so that it is evenly distributed. The sunlight is getting evenly distributed. And no point in having bigger sunlights, because it will carry a lot of heat. Now this light which is coming from the window and from the skylight is very different. So the skylight light carries more heat as compared to the light that is coming from the windows. Okay, so there can be different arrangements done to harvest light from the ceilings. So it can be sloped or these kind of arrangements. So one more commonly used kind of arrangement is nothing but north light, where you can say sawtooth, that is what they use. To harvest, here you can see one side it is having opaque surface, and another it is having a clear surface that is allowing light. So this is allowing north light to enter inside the building, and it is blocking the south light. Okay, so this is also one of the you can say most successful type of harvesting daylight, especially in the factory buildings, where they want to have lot of workers or these things. There are a lot of used machinery and these things they are working on. So then this will harvest only the diffused light, but not the heat. Okay, so north light can be used in different buildings. It is, the main idea is to use the sunlight. So here you can see if that is if the axis of the building is in this way, so then we can use lot of north light openings that are given on this north side. So this is also called as sawtooth. And if it is in the linear, if the longer axis is towards the east-west, then also we can have the north light roofing. Okay, and to harvest lot of sunlight. Okay, so this is nothing but again the light which is reflected will enter into this building. Okay. So lighting from the windows is having another, you can say, drawback, that it can't penetrate to the interior. Okay, so it has a certain limitations, such as based on the height of the opening of the building. If the opening is at a lower level, then light will penetrate to a very short distance. If it is in the higher level, then it can provide penetrate to a long, but it is again creating a shadow here. Okay, so then what we can do is we can increase the height so that it might get a lot of light. Okay. So usually what happens for these areas, we use artificial lighting to have a proper daylighting in all the areas where there is towards the windows, and also where to the interior spaces or inner spaces. Okay, so based on the light, that is daylight and the artificial light, we can try to maintain a proper daylight in the buildings. Okay. So here what they have done is they have tried to use a combination of both, that is lamps for the darker area where there is no light penetration, and this thing. So this can be actually resolved by redirecting light. Okay, so redirecting light is nothing but reflecting light from the windows and using it for the inner spaces. Okay, so it can be done. So these members can be horizontal, so they are called as light shells. So it can be in the form of vertical manner, so they are called as baffle. Okay, so they are in the roof, they are also trying to reflect light and diffuse light. Okay, so these are also, we can see, we'll see some examples where they are trying to use light shelves and also baffles. Okay, so to reflect sunlight. Okay, so this baffles, what it is reflecting light. So these elements or objects is reflecting light towards the ceiling, and ceiling is also very reflective and it is very light color. So it reflects the light further, and more light will penetrate inside the building, and there is less light or heat that is close to the window, because some of the light is again reflected and it is going inside the inside where there is requirement of natural daylighting. Okay, so this is called as light shelves, in which the light shelves are or the panels or the members are arranged in a horizontal manner. So that is called as light shelves. Okay, so based on the requirement, we can use the light. That is, if you want to cut, we can use these light shelves. If you want to reflect, you can change the angle so that we can have this can be a very high reflective surface, glossy surface where it will reflect light. So partially it is allowing light near the this thing window, and partially it is reflecting. Or if you want to a longer extent, so we can based on the sun path and understand what is the angle of incidence of the sunlight at particular time. So then we can reflect this light to the inner spaces where there is where the daylighting is required. Okay, so this is again a similar sketch that is explaining direct sunlight. Instead of getting lot of glare here, so there is some light which is entering diffused, and some light which is again reflected to the ceiling and which can be used. Okay, so this way I am avoiding this glare that is being created because of the direct sunlight, and also I am getting lot of light inside the building. Okay, where it is more required. Okay. And similarly, I can reduce the heat gain of the building inside the building, because I am cutting down the summer sunlight and I am allowing the winter sunlight, where I can use the heat of the building to improve my indoor environment. Okay, so during winters we need heating, and during summers we want to cut the sunlight because it is having a lot of thermal radiations or more thermal radiation during summer. So we usually want to cut that sunlight so it is reflecting. As it is reflecting or refracting or diffracting, so it is also losing out the heat. Okay, so heat is again absorbed by this object which the light is incident. So lot of heat is lost during the reflection, or you can say diffraction or reflection. Okay, so diffused or reflected light will have less heat as compared to direct sunlight. Okay, so that is why it is more beneficial to have these light shelves, so that you get diffused light and you get light in the required areas, that is the inner spaces, okay, not just in the windows. So this was again a Ismail Center in Toronto that was done by Charles Correa. So he used baffles. So this is a nice outdoor space where they can partially reflect or diffract sunlight. So instead of getting a very hot or lot of glare, they try to reduce this sunlight, okay, by using these baffles. Okay, so they can be used in interior or outside also. So concluding this presentation, in architectural design, lot of architects have also tried to work on this daylighting and this thing, how to harvest daylighting. Even traditional buildings also, there has been a constant approach towards utilizing the passive daylighting, or you can say daylighting for the buildings, so that the UV rays also are very important for the cleaning or maintaining hygiene, because they kill certain virus and bacteria and these things. So trying to maintain or improving the hygienic situation inside the indoor environment. Okay, so hence you can say that in architectural design, natural daylight is crucial, or you can say very important for determining sustainable building. Okay, and also to improve the quality of indoor air environment. Many significant factors determine the quality and quantity of daylight. Okay, so what is the quality of the daylight? That is, you can say in cold places you need heat along with the light. In hot places or tropical places, you don't need heat, but you need only the soft light. That is, that can be achieved by either orientation or massing or type or size of the building. Okay, and what are the what kind of glazing we use, what kind of glass we use, also plays an important significant role in harvesting daylight. Okay, the successful design of healthy building is controlled lighting and distribute spaces according to their needs. Okay, so based on different activities, based on different needs, like we use north light truss or north light in factories, industries, large spaces. So based on what kind of elements we need in a particular, you can say, different areas. So we need to use that and to create a healthy building. Okay. Using appropriate glazing specifications for buildings can result in reduced daylight levels and decrease in energy used for artificial lighting. The glazing can be again classified by different materials, that is translucent, what we studied. So it will partially allow light to pass through them. So there are certain lighting or glazing materials which will which are photochromatic, which will change the color of this thing. So again, reducing solar heat gain. There are lights which doesn't allow infrared. There are glasses which doesn't allow infrared radiations, cutting down all the heat. It will allow only the light, that is low E glass and different glasses that are available, which will cut the heat gain and it will allow only the sunlight. So that they play a major important role in the daylight. Okay. So this was about the daylighting, how to harvest and what are the different ways to achieve daylighting and what are the benefits of having a daylighting. Okay. So that was all for VTU Shikshana. Thank you.